Welcome back to the Data Science with MATLAB video series. In this video, we'll work on predictive modeling or machine learning. All right, so we went back and performed our analysis over all of the years. We've done our pre-processing, and we've got a good subset of data to continue to work with. Now we want to do a prediction of the damage costs based on the storm events and the other variables that we have in our table that we've been working with. So we'll need to do a couple of steps. First, we'll explore different types of ways to approach the problem. Then talk about data preparation, how to train and test the model, and then sort of what to do with it in the next step. So in this case, we have a lot of ways, you know, just generally speaking with predictive modeling, there are many, many ways to approach it depending on your goals and the situation, your data situation. So, you know, for example, you could do curve fitting, classification, regression, neural networks, deep learning, all of these kinds of things. And what's nice about MATLAB, doing these techniques in MATLAB, is that oftentimes we have apps that'll help you really explore and try a bunch of different models as you're going through these tasks. And so in this case, I'm trying to predict our damage cost. And so that's a numeric prediction. So I'll use regression. And before then, we want to make sure that we get the data in the right orientation for regression or for machine learning. So let's take a look at the data that we have just as a reminder. So we have our location, the state, the time information, the type of event, the storm duration, and the damage costs. And so we want to be able to, for our prediction, we need to capture all of the information that might be useful to predict. And so we want to predict based on time, but not necessarily in a time series way. We just want to represent the time information. So we can just split up the year, month, day, and hours and use that in the model to see how those are influencing the prediction or the costs. So for example, you know, a blizzard in July likely is more costly. And so we'll use that information in the model. Another thing that we want to do is to remove the infrequent classes. And so in this case, we'll remove anything that has less than 200 events. So whenever we're building models like this, we also want to partition the data so that we have a data set held out for testing. So we'll split up our data into training and testing sets and a 70-30 split. So now I'm going to train our model, and we use an app. And so here I'm just, I open the regression learner and we'll select the data. So I'm just going to select the training data set that we created. And I want to select the response. So that's what I'm trying to predict, which is our damage total. And then I can select or deselect the data I don't need. So for example, I don't need the property and crop damage or latitude, longitude, because I'm representing that data in a different way. With regression, we've got a bunch of different models. And so if you have some indication of what model you might want to use, you could select that. Or, you know, maybe you know that it's linear, you could select all linear. In this case, I'll just select all of them. Why not? Depending on how many cores you have available, you can use parallel, and that'll take advantage, train as many models as you can at once. And then you can take a great look at the visualizations, you know, even while it's training, to explore, you know, see some of the patterns perhaps. And then there are some nice visualizations once the models have trained to see, to validate the models. So for example, you can look at residuals and, you know, examine the predictions versus the actual data. And so the visualizations also help with this. You know, for example, some of these categories have a lot of outliers, like our hurricanes, and, you know, it's able to predict the lower values much better than the higher values. And so these are the kinds of things that we want to look at in the app and, you know, take advantage of by training all of these different models. So once we're happy with a model, we can actually export it, so we can start to use it for predictions later. And not only can we export the model, but we can generate the code. And that way we can repeat the same exact steps that we went through, But using a function instead of, you know, going through using the app every time, you can very quickly use the function after this. And also learn how to adapt the model yourself. I exported the model from the app, and now I'm going to use it in our prediction. So when you export the model from the app, it's actually inside of a struct, and it contains information about the model and even a function to help you predict using that model, taking the same steps and the same variables as before. The app actually held out data for testing, for training and validation. We also did that before training the model. And so now we want to test the model on our test data that we, you know, had not passed into the app. And so now I'll predict based on the test data, and I can use a histogram of the errors or how far away the model predicted from the real data. Whenever we deploy this model and we put it into our app, we're going to be getting the information real time. So we'll type in the location and the type of event. But we basically just want to make sure we have the same steps followed and the data is in the same organization or the same types that we originally trained the model. And so it's, you know, it would be very expensive to have a tornado right now in Massachusetts.
Thanks for watching. In the next video, we'll look at scaling up our calculations to big data.